So, we're talking about don't let these things slip. This is the new series. We're going back. We're going back. There's no need to go forward with new information when you're not seeing the information of the past go on. If you don't know what you learned last year, and you're not exemplifying what you did last year, well, let's go from grades. If you didn't learn what you need to learn in kindergarten, why go to first grade? Because guess what? The stuff that in kindergarten, you got to take it in the first grade to keep you enhanced. You don't forget that. We learn adding in kindergarten. We learn different colors and different things. It prepared me for the next thing. So we can't let these things slip. All the things that we have learned in this ministry. I've been here growing on 19 years. So many things have been taught by apostles. Many things have been downloaded into me. And if you've been here however long you've been here, you learn many things to help you and to enhance you. So we've been taught many things here at Kingdom Faith. Everything that we have been taught is a building block. He's building us up in God. He built us up in faith. He built us up in love. He built us up in belief. He built us up in every, and the Bible covers every part. There's no part of your life that the Bible don't touch. There's no issue. There's no problem. There's no thing that you ever gonna face that the Bible don't have an answer for. It has an answer for it. It has a resolution for it. And so faith is one of the most important teachings that we have been taught here. And we've been taught series after series, lessons after lessons of faith. We got many things that we can pull from when it comes to faith. He taught many different aspects of it. But we can't forget that. And we must never let the message of faith slip. We must never let the message of faith slip. Why? Because in this day and time, what's being attacked? Your faith. What are people talking about? God ain't dead. God ain't dead. The Bible ain't dead. The Bible ain't dead. Jesus ain't dead. Jesus ain't dead. That's all you hear. And if you are not standing on the foundation that you've been built on, guess what? You can easily slip off that foundation. You can easily be knocked off that foundation. And it's so much more than what you're standing on physically. It's what's inside of you. It's what's in you. What have we allowed to get in? Out of all the things that we have heard, what have really gotten in us? What are we really living? What are we really applying to our lives? So, for these teachings are to help us, are part of our foundation that we stand on in our faith in God. So as we look into this, Hebrews 2:1, that's our base scripture. It says we must not let these things slip. The scripture been read. But let's go to, we're talking about faith. We're talking about faith. Where is your faith? What do you have faith in? Or who do you have faith in? See, it's a lot. See, just because you got faith, you hear people say, oh, I got faith. I got faith. I believe. Yeah. Okay, believing is what? At the end of that, what is believing? Believing is so much more than just what's in your head. Remember, we've been taught that. It's so much more than a mental ascent of what's in your head. Everything that I believe is everything that I do. Okay. Yeah. What kind of washing power you believe in? Okay. What kind of washing power do you use? What kind of toothpaste do you believe in? What kind of toothpaste do you use? So, if we say we believe the word of God and we have faith in it, are we using it? We can't get away from it. God is the one thing in your life you can't get around. You can't avoid. You got to deal with him at some point in time. Either the first part of your life, the middle part of your life, or the end, you're not going to get around him. And remember, there are two things you can't run away from, and God is one. The other is you. We can't run away from ourselves. Yeah. So let's look into this faith lesson. It's so much on it that I'm not gonna finish. I ain't trying to finish. But let's look at Romans 12 and 3. It says, "For by grace, by the grace of God given to us." Remember, grace is an empowerment. That's another thing coming up. Grace is an empowerment. It's an empowerment for you to overcome. You have all been empowered to overcome whatever you're facing, whatever come against you. You have a grace on you to overcome that, even if that grace is for overcoming you. You have a grace. It's an empowerment for that. So God given to me, I say to every one of you, not to think more highly of yourself as his importance and ability. Why? Because what did you make? What did you create? Who did you die for? What did you sacrifice for? Nothing. Nobody. God did it all for you. Then he ought to think. But to think so as he should, have sound judgment. The Bible says have a sober opinion of yourself. A sober opinion of yourself. When people are under the influence, guess what? That ain't you. You ain't being influenced by something or by someone. But when you have a sober opinion of yourself, you see yourself just like God sees you. Just like God sees you. So, and God has appointed to each a degree of faith. One translates say a measure of faith and a purpose designed for service. So each one of us has been given a measure of faith. One translates say the measure of faith. Now, before I came here, I was taught that measure was a little bitty piece of who God was. It was a little bitty piece of what Jesus, but we learned here something different, that we received the full measure. We didn't receive a little tablespoon measure. I left my props. We didn't receive the tablespoon measure. We didn't receive the teaspoon measure. We received a full measure of what God had in him, what Christ had in him, the same very thing. But I hear people say, well, I'm Christ-like, but I'm not him. What do Christ-like mean? My son look just like me. He ain't just like me. He is me. He think like me. My daughter, she don't look that much like me, but she look like my mama, like the one I came out of, and guess what? She act like her daddy. I see. So is Christ like? You are just like him, because you got the same measure of faith as him. So what is faith? What is faith? Faith is belief. So we got the same belief. We got the trust. How did Christ believe? He believed what his father said. He believed that he could do what his father said he could do. We got the same. He trusted his father. Guess what? We got to trust God the same way if we're going to get the same results. He had confidence in his father. Do you have confidence in God?
Yes, sir.
Whatever you got confidence in, guess what? You got faith in it. Do you got more faith in other things than you do in God? Come on, I remember when I had more faith in myself than I had in God. But God made me. So how could I have more faith in me, in my understanding, in my way of doing things than he is?
That comes from having more faith in what you're trying to do for God.
Right. So it also means to persuade. It's a God's divine persuasion. That is true faith. When you are persuaded to believe just like God believed.
Yeah.
You're persuaded to know just like he knows. But it takes something to get there.
Amen.
It takes something to get there. So I already spilled it, but the first point is we had the same spirit of faith that Christ had.
Amen.
Christ didn't have some special super galactic anointing. He didn't have more than what you had.
That's right.
But guess what he did do? He surrendered to God totally. So that what was in him, let's go to the scripture. 2 Corinthians 4:11. We got the same thing that he had.
Amen.
We got the same thing that he had. Same power. Mm-hmm. Same power. Same ability. We got the same thing. God didn't just water all down and give him something else. No. It says, for we who live are constantly experiencing the threats of being handed over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the resurrection life of Jesus also may be evidence to our mortal body, which is subject to death. Guess what? The same thing you're subject to, Christ was subject to. If a pandemic had happened back then, guess what? He had the same suggestion. But the same issue. There was homosexuality then too. There was drugs then too. There was all kind of prostitution. There was whatever, gambling, everything. Yeah, it's just wide open now. Ain't nothing new. The same issue, the same problem, the same peer pressure. Christ had the same issue that we did. But how did he deal with it? How did he handle it? He handled it with the word of God. So it says, so physical death is actively at work in us, but spiritual life is actively at work in you. When Christ got in the tub, the same little ring that we have, he had the same ring too. It wasn't just white. It wasn't just pure. He got dirty. His feet got dirty just like y'all did. He sweated just like you did. He had problems and issues just like you did. He had an opportunity to stress out just like you did. They with it. But what did he do? He depended on his Father. He had faith in his Father. 13 says, yet you have the same spirit of faith as that he had. Who is he? Christ. You had the same spirit of faith that he had, who wrote in scripture, I believe, therefore I spoke. Guess what? We believe, therefore we spoke. Remember the series, you can have what you say? But the apostle said, we say what we have. Guess what? Jesus just didn't go running off at his mouth. He didn't just go talking all willy-nilly. He was careful about what he said. He was careful about how he said it. And guess what? Since you got the same spirit of faith, guess what? We can't just say anything. When we say, I can't, guess what? God provision say, nah, you can't. God told me one time, he said, when you say you can't do it or you're not able to, he said, then my provisions ain't made for you. My provision can't meet you there because you spoke it. You put it into existence. This is why we had to be careful. No.
Your will is that it can't be done. Why would he
bump or stand and go do it? Right. But you hear people say, but I thought God was sovereign. I thought he could do whatever he wanted to when he wanted to. But he can't violate you. If you don't want to do it, he's not going to put you in the headlock and make you. He not. But if you want to trust him, if you want to put all your weight on him, like everybody done put all their weight on these pews, and then nobody checked their pew before they sat down, did they? No. God will allow you to see him. So if you have the same spirit that Christ had, then we got to do what Christ did. We got to operate like he operated. Number one, he submitted to God. Number one, he listened to God. When his flesh riled up, guess what? He put his flesh under subjection with the faith that he had in God. He did that. We got to do the same thing. Yeah.
That was trying to lead him out of the will of God under the power of the Spirit.
Right. And your feelings, have you ever had bad feelings and bad emotions and you was in the wrong place and you made the right decision? I ain't never made the right decision when I was in my feelings, when I made in my emotion itself. I ain't never made the right decision. And you never will either. Number two, Our faith has to be cultivated and developed. My neighbor said it last week. Your faith got to be cultivated. What do cultivation mean? It means to grow. So it has to grow. It has to be nurtured. It has to be tended to. You got to tend to your faith. You got to watch your faith. You got to be a former of your ground. You can't just let different stuff come up in your spirit. You can't let different stuff get into your spirit through what you watch, through what you see, through what you listen to, through who you hang around. You got to be attentive to your faith. You could be around somebody that got a whole bunch of doubt. Don't think it ain't going to have an effect on your faith. You got to be on guard. Yes. Right. That's it. Another definition of cultivate means to finish. A man has to finish his family. But guess what? If I ain't finished, how am I going to finish you? If I ain't where I need to be in God, how I'm supposed to help somebody else get to where they need to be? It was. Even people with great wealth, financial, the least wealth, they don't just give their kids that money. They send them to finishing school, to boarding school, to prepare them for the wealth that they, so that the wealth can continue. If they put that in the hands of somebody that don't know what they're doing, what's going to happen to it?
All right, bring it on. What did it do right here?
This school.
We training you on how to
handle. Yeah. Sunday school, Bible study, worship service. It's not something to be taken for granted. It's not something to be taken for granted. You are being built for today, tomorrow, and eternity. Yeah. All of that, you being built. So development, it means to grow. It means to become more mature. But I thought Jesus, when he paid it all and he finished, he said when it finished, he finished it. He was talking about God finishing. Ain't nobody going to have to die no more for your sin. Ain't nobody going to have to shed no more blood no more for sin. He finished the work that God created him to do. Yeah, but when it comes to your faith and your growth, guess what? You got a part to play in that. Can't nobody, you heard the disciples say, Lord, increase our faith. He didn't address it because nobody can grow your faith and help to develop your faith but you. You're responsible for that. Huh? You have a part to play, but if we don't surrender to the word, right.
You helping me, my pastor, helping me, my neighbor, all of y'all that's teaching in there helping me.
Right.
Help the people, but they wanted to rely on somebody else out there. They don't want to bear no regret. They not know
it. Yep. You teaching, woman of God teaching, everybody teaching, but it's up to us to apply.
That's
true. It's up to us to put it together.
That's what I'm saying.
It's up to us. The word of God. It's strong. It is pure. It is incorruptible. But it had to be mixed with faith. It had to be mixed with faith. So, where we at? So, it also means to become more mature, to be advanced, and to be elaborate. Your faith is supposed to be advanced. Your faith is supposed to be elaborate. Anything that's elaborate, it stands out. You... Right.
There's something in here that ain't been in here before, and they know who it is.
Mm-hmm.
But you also can tell when something come in that don't supposed to be in there.
Right.
Same way.
You can. So, like that's undeveloped? Do you like anything that's undeveloped? When you go in the store looking for plum, you looking for the undeveloped plum? You looking for the green one, you looking for the right one? You don't want the overripe, but you want the one that's just right. Watermelon season coming up. You want the baby watermelon or you want the biggest one? You want the one that's right. You want the one that is developed. But what about us in God? What about our faith? Don't we want to develop our faith? Do we want to stay in the name down to sleep, pray the Lord my soul to keep, pastor not before away? Do we want to continue to pray that same thing? Do we want to continue to live it? You got to start from somewhere. Everybody got to start from somewhere. But we got to grow. Let's talk about the egg. Apostle used that egg years ago. That egg has a yolk, and it has what's the other part of it? The whiting. But guess what? That egg has a chicken in it. It has a chicken in it. But it's an undeveloped chicken. It has the same potential that these chickens walking around clucking, doing everything, trying to fly, eating up everything. It had the same potential in it, but it was undeveloped. What happened to the undeveloped one? It didn't get fertilized. The process got stopped some kind of way. Is it still good? Yeah. Is it good for a lot of things? Yeah. But it never reached its full potential. It never reached its full potential.
Yeah.
And the faith that Christ gave us, the measure that you got, guess what? It was created for us to meet our full potential. It wasn't created for us to stay in the egg mold, the yolk mold. It wasn't created for that. We supposed to go all the way to the zenith of what God wants us to be. So we all have the potential to be like Christ, but do we want to develop? You got the same faith that Christ had. But do you want to develop this faith? Do you want to grow? Do you want to be what the book said we can be? Do we want to be the picture on the salvation box, the Christian box? Do we want to be that?
Look on us like Paul said, mark us so you have us for an example.
Right.
That's where we got to get you.
Right. Do you want to be the example? Because guess what? You're going to be an example whether you become the example or not. I learned this. Either you're going to be the example of what right to do, or you're going to be the example of wrong. Ain't no in between.
No. You one or the other.
Which example do you want to be? I've been the example of wrong for the long enough. I'm trying to be the example of God.
Amen.
When I first got to this ministry and I joined, the pastor said, look at me, I'm the example. Me as an unbeliever, as an immature Christian, was looking at everybody else because I felt like he the pastor. He can't be the example because there's something else on him. He got a different anointing. He got a different spirit. He's supposed to walk right. You heard people say, oh, you're supposed to be a preacher. You're supposed to do this. You're supposed to be a Christian. You're supposed to walk right. You ain't supposed to mess up. You're supposed to overcome. I'm looking at a lesser example. But God set the standard. The standard was him. The standard. Jesus is the example for a reason. He shows us how he was 100% man, 100% God in the flesh. And he showed us how to overcome by just submitting to God. Is it easy? What's another thing we heard? Faith makes it, don't make it easy, but it make it possible.
Are we looking for easy?
Yeah. We looking for you. I'm still looking for that one pill I can take once a week where I can eat what I want, I can drink what I want, I can live however I want, and I'm still going to lose weight. I'm still looking for that. I want that pill.
Even though they lying, getting promotion and getting folks money, ain't nothing like that.
No. Because even if it was a pill, it's still going to be some work entail. So we ask the question, how do we develop? Guess what? We all got a six-pack in here. I got a six-pack. But guess what? It's undeveloped. But I got the same potential of the six-pack that Caleb got, I got. I got that. I can have it. But I'm going to have to put some work in to get there. I'm going to have to put something in. So let's go to James 2. Let's let the scripture talk for itself. I think we're in James. James 2 and 14. Faith without works. If we're going to develop, we got to work. A bodybuilder can't go into a weight room and just have knowledge of the weights and develop. He can't go in there and just be in the weight room. Oh, I'm going to the gym. I've been in the gym all day, but they ain't lift not one weight. Ain't nothing finna happen. Oh, I went to church Sunday. Oh, I read my Bible. Oh, I know the scriptures. But if I never apply, ain't nothing gonna happen. Grace in the door don't thank you. Grace in the door don't qualify you for nothing. But it does make you accountable. And we heard a lot of messages. So we're accountable to everything that we heard. And God know we heard. So James 2 and 14. And it says, What is the benefit, my fellow believers, if someone claims to have faith but has no good works or evidence? Where is your evidence? We say we saved. There should be some evidence. We say we studying. We living for God. There should be some evidence. Yep. We say that we are God. There should be some evidence. Amen. Where is our evidence? And it says, can that kind of faith save him? No. No, a mere claim of faith is not sufficient. Me just saying, oh, I went to the gym this morning, y'all. Oh, I'm even right. I'm changing my lifestyle. Do you see the evidence of that? No. And so, it says, a mere claim of faith is not sufficient. Genuine faith produces good works. So faith is supposed to produce. Your faith in God is supposed to be productive. This is why we got to develop. We're supposed to be productive as Christians. We're supposed to be producing. Number one, it's supposed to produce love, peace, joy. Mama Abby said it last week. God's faith worked by God's love. Didn't you say that? God's faith worked by God's love. But what if we ain't working no love? You can have all the faith in the world you want. Ain't nothing finna happen. So, it said, if a brother or sister is without adequate clothing and lacks enough food for each day, and one of you says to him, go in peace, with my blessing, keep warm and feed yourselves, but he does not give him the necessities of the body, what good does that do? What good is that? We and the church, we should. One of my friends in Houston, he has a church. He renamed it. He calls it Demonstrate Church. And guess what? They are demonstrating Christ in the community. They demonstrate Christ They're doing what it takes. They ain't just talking the talk. They ain't just showing up in the building. The real ministry on the outside. We meet here to get the information. Yeah. Right. We meet here to get the information, to get the training, to get the enlightenment so that we can take that back out. The real ministry out there, you ain't gonna really find out who God is until you go out there. Yeah, right. Yeah, we just hear about him in here. We talk about him in here. We hear what other people say. But until you apply for your own self, until you get in there your own self, until you get into the weight room, Satan gonna bring the development to you. He gonna help you develop and he don't even know what he helping you. He gonna give you an opportunity to develop. Because he's going to bring that one person that don't like you, that one person that hates you, the situation that come up in your life. That's development time. That's growth time. And I remember being the one to run from that. Don't want to go through nothing. Don't want to face nothing. Don't want to be met by nothing. Right. That's it. That's it. There was no yellow brick road experience in faith. You're going to face something. You're going to have to grow. I know when I grew up, the deacon said, oh, when you come into God, everything going to be all right. And you're going to have no more problems, no more issues. That was the worst thing that man could ever told me. And I bought it.
Yep,
I believed it. But somebody told me it was real. I said, oh, you done got saved. Oh, now it's finna get real now. Now you finna see. Because Satan wants you back. You his ex-girlfriend or boyfriend. He wants you. He don't want to let you go. So it says, so to faith, if it does not have works to back it up, it by itself is dead, inoperative and inactive. Is your faith active or inactive? Remember, everything about God is action. How is your love? Is your love active? Is your love operative? Is it being used every day? Is the word active in your life? Remember, the word works if we work it. But if we don't work the word, guess what? It ain't going to happen for us. And our faith won't be developed unless we develop it. Unless we put it to the test. It takes faith to obey God.
Yep.
It takes faith to love. It takes faith to forgive. Because a lot of times you're going to be forgiving somebody that ain't sorry for what they did. That don't care about what they did. You're going to love somebody that ain't going to love you back. That takes faith to do that. That takes faith to do that. You're going to be obeying something that you really, in your flesh, ain't really believing that it can really happen, that you really can't see. But once you do it, then you will see that it's real. It says, so, but someone may say, you claim to have faith, and I have good works. Show me your alleged faith without the works, if you can. Yeah. can I show you that I got faith without you seeing anything? Can I show you that I got love and you never see no love?
Okay.
But you can show somebody something without saying anything.
That's right.
You can show somebody you love them without saying anything at all.
Right.
It's all about your action. You can show somebody you hate them without even saying anything at all. It's all about your action. And you can show the world that you got faith by what did the church universally show the world in this pandemic? We had an opportunity, man, to show the world what faith really looked like. And they were looking for that. They wanted to see that at a time where they needed to see the church rise, that they needed to see the favor of God. What did we universally show them? We missed it universally. We didn't miss it here. Thank God that we are under a man and woman of God that have faith and that live faith. Well, we could have missed it just like everybody else did. And so it said, you believe that God is one. And you do well to believe that. The demons also believe that and shudder and bristle in all fear terror. They have seen his wrath. So they believe that they're God.
Yeah, they got faith.
You hear a lot of people say, oh, I believe in God.
It's on that level of the devil.
Yeah.
Speaking of the devil.
I believe in God.
They work for the king.
But how do you believe? How do you believe? Is your belief correct? Is your belief right? Is your belief on point? Is it belief? Because many people believe in God now, but when it comes to Jesus, they miss that part. They think they ain't connected together, but they are. They one. We can't believe in one. They say, but you're willing to recognize, you foolish, spiritually shallow person, that faith without good works is useless. Faith without good works is useless. Us coming in here, hearing all this word, hearing all these series, sitting here time after time, day after day, hour after hour, and not leaving here and using it, we could have been at home fishing. Yeah. Like Apostle Washington said, we could have been at home watching Gunsmoke. We are not here. We cannot come here just to be sitting in here, just to check off the box saying that, oh, I went to church, or I went to service. We should be taking these lessons and sharing it with somebody. Somebody didn't go. Somebody ain't thinking about going. And the church shouldn't be just these four walls. When we show up, that's the church is there. The church can be anywhere. We can be anywhere. And represent God in a way. And our faith should be in it and everywhere. So 21 says, was our father Abraham not shown to be justified by works or obedience which expressed his faith? Wasn't he an example of faith? He ain't the father of faith for no reason.
That's right.
He ain't the father of faith for no reason. When a father is what? He births, he produces, he makes other. And by watching his life, how many other people were birthed into faith by watching him, by following him? Guess what? There are other people that's supposed to be birthed in faith by watching you. Your life should birth something. My children need to see something. They need to see me doing stuff in faith. They need to see me operating in faith, working in faith. My coworker need to see that. The guys I'm under, they need to see that.
Right.
Your people need to see that. Your family need to see that. They need to see.
And the one that won't come out, they'll follow you.
Right.
They'll want what you got. That's how you decide to
be. That's it. It said, you see that his faith was working together with his works.
Right.
And as a result of the works, his faith was completed, reaching its maturity when he expressed his faith through his obedience. He expressed his faith through his obedience. Guess what? If you saying you believe, but you ain't doing nothing.
You're right. Tell me, you're not obedient.
Right.
You don't have it.
You don't.
You got it, but you don't.
You don't. You can't say that I believe in tithe, but when I go to your house, I see gain.
Yeah.
Something wrong with this. You can't say that. So we got that same potential that Christ had. And 23 says, and the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and this faith was credited to him by God as righteousness, as conformity to his will. And he was called the friend of God.
Amen.
And he was called the friend of God. Jesus said, you are my friend. It would. If you obey me.
Well, that's something better. And remember that song, Getting Real? You
know, right. Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So our faith has to be developed. A couple more points I want to say. Tough times help to develop your faith. A bodybuilder can't go in and lifting lightweight and develop into this massive bodybuilder that he wants to be. He got to put some resistance.
Yep.
He got to put something on there. So when the enemy comes against you, that's an opportunity for you to develop in faith. When people come against you, that's an opportunity for you to develop in faith. Like Apostle just said, you don't develop on sunny days. Wins only do so much for you. But you can learn more in losses than in wins. So that from now on, now you know how to win from a loss. You can develop from that. It can build you. So faith is action. It takes faith to love. It takes faith to obey. It takes faith to follow God. It takes faith. And last but not least in this lesson, The same faith that we start with should not be the faith that we finish with. I'm going to say it again. The same faith that we start with should not be the same faith that we finish with. Why? Because I got saved. I've been in church all my life. But the church ain't been in me all my life. The church really got in me. I allowed to get in me when I really first got here. So I've been saved close to 15, 16 years. But the same faith that I had then is not the same faith that I got now. Why? Because I have allowed, first of all, I had to get out of God's way. I had to allow him to be who he is. I had to really see him for what he was. I had to bump my head by not listening to the man of God. But it has helped me to grow. It has helped me to build. Let's go to Romans 1 and 17. The same faith that we have now shouldn't be the same faith that we finish with. Amen. We ought to be continuing in faith and growing in faith until Christ come back. And then when we get up there, the faith continues to grow. It don't stop.
We still going to be learning
there. Right.
There's no
end. So Romans 1 and 17 says, "For in the gospel of righteousness of God, God is revealed, both springing from faith and leading to faith."
Wait a minute. Springing
from faith.
Leading to.
Right. Right. So he started it off. He gave us a full measure. The same measure that he had. But guess what? Christ didn't stay right there. Now, he didn't come out laying hands. He didn't come out speaking. He had to go to the synagogue. He learned. He developed. He went from somewhere. He didn't just come out leading people, pulling people out. He wasn't no... And you hear people say, "Oh, well, Jesus was preaching as a little boy."
No, he wasn't.
What could he really preach?
The Jewish male is not 30 years old, so that's
right.
You got to know the customs.
Exactly.
Any time for John the Baptist started here that 30.
Right.
That was the custom because the Jesus that went against the old law that they had in place, he couldn't fulfill our righteousness. He would have been disobedient to fulfill the law.
That's it. And at 12, what had he really overcome?
What the scripture
through the things that he suffered. And your faith is going to grow and develop out of the things that you suffer. Because you have to learn how to endure those things. You have to learn how to overcome those things through the word of God. It don't just happen by happenstance. We got to learn that. So it said, spring from faith and leading to faith, disclosed in a way that awakens more faith. So you start from one place, and you see God working here, and you believe God in this area, and he worked it out. It's going to make you want to do more. I ain't never seen somebody that start making money, and they just want to stay there. Don't you want more? I ain't never seen somebody be successful in this area and say, "Oh, well, I'm successful, I'm good." But you hear people say, "Oh, I just want to make it to heaven. I just want to make it in." That's all you want? That's all you want? I want to be in the sweet by and by. I want to stick my sword in the golden sand. We're supposed to be experiencing the benefits of that right now. We don't have to wait till we get there. We're supposed to be experiencing peace right now. Which that'll spill over into salvation. We supposed to be getting a whole piece of the pie.
Right.
But there's another message. But it said disclose in a way that awakens more faith. As it is written, and forever mean written, the just and upright shall live by faith. Faith is not just something that we live by while we're inside the four walls. Faith is a lifestyle. We should do everything in faith. When you go to work tomorrow, you should get up in faith, drive in faith, and go to work in faith.
Yeah.
We should be. So people should know we're a Christian on our job just by the way that we work. This is the way we show up on time. We don't complain. We don't do this. We don't do that. We don't follow the trends of the world. But in order for to go from faith to faith, we have to start somewhere. But we have to develop. We have to grow. We got to finish what God already started. What did he say? He begun a good work in us. He began a good work in us. The good work was him putting his faith in us. But now the Bible tells us that we got to work out our own salvation. So your growth and development in faith is up to you. What you gonna do? Be blessed. Thank you.